The thing was turned on. Got turned on. Too tired. They're taking me out, I'm too tired. Right. And then, let's see, another car.
Thank you.
know.
You listening to commentators today, as I've been addressed, might think that we should be disappointed. But when we passed the American Rescue Plan, I want to remind you, it was designed to help us over the course of a year, not 60 days, a year. We never thought that after the first 50 or 60 days, everything would be fine. Today, there's more evidence that our economy is moving in the right direction. But it's clear we have a long way to go. All told, our economy has added more than 1,500,000 new jobs since I took office. That's the most number of jobs created in the first 3 months of any presidency in our history. Just for perspective, in these 3 months before I got here, the economy added about 60,000 jobs a month, about 500,000. In the 3 months since I've been here, the economy has added 500,000 jobs a month. This is progress, and it's a testament to our new strategy of growing this economy from the bottom up and the middle out.
I'm working on it, you know, work on it in my teaching, I work on it, you know, writing and talking, and I'm not sure how it comes out, but I promise you this, we have not seen the last of the white reaction and backlash to a changing demographic country. And my wife asked me, just the other day, we were talking about this, about why would George Floyd, the tragedy of George Floyd, the murder of George Floyd, why did that prompt what it prompted, let's say, Trayvon Martin?
Right.
And of course, if you think historically, you go back and you think of the timeline of civil rights. So why didn't Emmett Till meet?
Right.
So to some extent, you don't know where you are until you're through it.
Precisely.
And I think that the other key element here is that this is a demographically changing country. And that's why so many white folks are reacting the way they are, is they feel hegemony slipping away. And so, to some extent, the Trump era is an affirmation of the basic demographic reality. And I don't think it's the last spasm, but we live in a different country than we did in 1965. So let's hope we live in a different and better country than in 2035, than we do now.
Several weeks ago, a guest on this program, someone I know you know and admire, Ron Brownstein, was on talking about his book, Rock Me on the Water, which argues that the cultural shift of... tensions going across the culture, then Trump is an extension of that. And just as whites motivated by Nixon in 68 and 72 saw something was changing in their country, so did all the Trump supporters I saw and met and interacted with more than 75 Trump rallies in the 2016 campaign. And I've said this on this program many times, the more psychological politics becomes, the more dangerous it becomes, the more unstable it becomes. I like the thought.
Richard Hofstadter, at this point, incredibly well. Hofstadter's one of these guys that impresses me because he said everything that needs to be said better than I ever will, and it was 70 years ago. He wrote an essay, which I'm sure you know, called The Rise of the Pseudo-Conservative, and it was in the late 50s, early 60s. It was the Trump book. And what he was talking about was when politics is a mediation of interests, it's more rational. When it is a battle over status, it becomes irrational. And that's where we are. And one of the fascinating things, and this has been true in the South for generation upon generation upon generation, is that culture and race have, and status, have divided a natural alliance based on economic interests, right? Black folks and white working white folks have more in common than they have apart. But the diabolical insight of so many white segregationist politicians was divide them with power and status, because the working white folks, you tell them, the only thing you've got is you're not one of them.
That is the voice of John Meacham. John, you need to jump in and take a break, but on the other side of the break, we'll continue this conversation and get on to all the more news of the day. I'm Major Garrett. This is The Takeout. Back for segment three in just a second.
We came as close to losing the country as we know it on January 6th, as we have since the Civil War.
Thank you.
It's a very intrusive radar. So, and I haven't taken my transmitter in my office apartment. So I just took it. I'll probably go. Okay, so please make them feel sorry for themselves, increasing in intensity an infinite number of times, a resilience of a second for an infinite number of eternities. Affirm, reaffirm. Affirm, reaffirm. I have an infinite number of infinities. caught my stomach. Oh, okay. I mean, it's not midnight yet. Okay, we stopped recording. I'll close this.